So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are the panel today here is to discuss the positioning and how to take advantage of opportunities in shipping. And we have a panel of esteemed shipowners that I'm going to introduce quickly. We have Mr. Peter Pappas, CEO of Starbuck, Mr. Andreas Hadjiyiannis, the president of Cyprus Sea Lines and also the president of Cyprus Union of Shipowners, Ms. Nicole Mylona, CEO of Transmed, Mr. Aristides Pittas, the CEO of Euroseas and Eurodry, and Mr. Hajioannou, the CEO of Safe Bulkers. So we are also a bit pressed on time, so I'm going to shoot with, I think, the most hot topic in shipping these days, which is it has to do with the environmental regulations for 2020. I should start with Mr. Pappas, since he's the first in the row. Do you think the environmental regulations for 2020, they have become a game changer for the industry? And are you planning into some specific strategy to comply with these regulations?
You want me to reveal all my secrets?
The ones you can.
Okay, first, good afternoon to all the heroic people that are still here after how many hours?
Nobody
has left.
I know.
I think we're full house at the moment.
Right. So I think that, to answer your first question, I think that if it was not for those environmental regulations, we would see a market which would be falling going forward. I think that they will assist the whole shipping community, because vessels will slow down their speed, because there's going to be more scrapping, vessels that won't be able to follow. And also, there's less ordering at this point in time, at least from private ship owners, exactly because they do not know what the future has in store. So in that sense, if you ask me how the market is going to be in the future without it, I would be very worried about it. Because of those regulations, I have a different view, but I am sure we'll discuss it later on. Our company has decided to install scrappers on almost 100% of the fleet. Do you want me to give reasons for that as well, or just what do you want to do?
Just some
okay.
Summary.
Well, bullet points. I think that it is a good hedging tool. If the market goes down in 2020, although we believe it will not, if it does, on dollars per ton basis, this will mean that a vessel that was making like $14,000 a day, let's say last November, it will have to pay from those $14,000 additional dollars per day for the consumption of diesel oil or other blends, and this $14,000 could go down to $6,000-$8,000 exactly because of that additional cost, where if you have a scrubber, basically you would probably make the same money or even a little bit better, because you may be burning cheaper heavy fuel oil. So that's one of the reasons we're doing it. The second reason we're doing it is because operationally it would change nothing for our company. We'll continue to burn heavy fuel oil as we've burned in the past. So all these issues about blends or compatible fuel oils, we're not going to be facing. So these are the reasons why we're doing it.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Hadjiyiannis, do you share the same ideas and thoughts with regards to how the market will be affected, and also are you taking same kind of strategy for the future going into 2020?
Okay. I think, first of all, good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for being here. I think IMO has made a terrible job. It's a disgrace. It turned the shipping market or the transportation market into a casino. What will happen in a few months' time? Nobody knows. There are too many ifs and too many uncertainties. So the market has already been affected by that. The shippers, for instance, they don't know. Will they book their cargoes from now with a surcharge? Some people are calling because of the increase of the fuel oil cost. Would the charterer go and charter a ship without knowing what will happen on 1st of January? So all this brought the industry into a big standstill. And we saw that with the freights. The freights have come down by what, 70%? So it's already a bad market. What would actually happen is anybody's guess. Now, the scrappers is one thing. I'm not going to criticize it, if it's good or bad, it's anybody's own opinion. But the fact is that there are only 2,000, 2,500 ships in an industry where it operates with 60, 70, 80,000 ships. So we cannot have shipping on 1st of January with 2,000 ships. How the IMO would handle this? I don't know. I don't think there is an answer to that. Why we ended up in this mess? The IMO managed somehow a very simple problem, which is a will to reduce the sulfur contents into the marine fuel oil down to 0.5%, and to a big uncertainty. We've been through phases like this before. We had the 1% sulfur contents, and we lived with that for a few years. No disruption, no weeds, no bugs. Instead of improving that, or extending the areas to a bigger areas like the closed seas they're talking about now, or reducing the 1% down to 0.8, 0.6 gradually to have a very smooth transitional period to what they want to achieve by 2020, they scrap it. So they scrap the 1% and then they introduce a new regulation years later on the 0.5. Now, an ordinary mind would think, okay, first you make sure that this is available and then you impose to the consumer a deadline. It's like tomorrow a government says from such and such a date all the cars must be electric. First, you have to have the plaque on the roads for the car users charge their batteries, and then you impose on the public. IMO went the opposite way. Now, I don't buy the reason that they cannot control the refineries. First of all, they didn't try to put it on the refineries, which are the ultimate responsible people to produce the right product. But I don't buy the reason that they do not control them. I cannot understand a better proposition to the refiners or to any producer where you tell them, I will guarantee you the buyer, you produce the product. The only question to that would be what's the price? And the price is, you name it. So what producer who come up and say, no, we don't do it.
So I get it that you believe the disruption will be huge, basically.
I believe it won't happen. I believe as we get closer to 2020, on this, on today's basis, it won't happen.
Okay.
They won't stop shipping.
Uh-huh.
They will find the ways around it. And what that ways is, they made the mess, they must find the solution.
That will not stop the fuel, the old fuel, from being used.
If there is a substitute, yes. If there's no substitute, they can't stop shipping.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. To go next to Ms. Mylona, being mainly into a dry cargo owner, I'm not going to ask if it's going to disrupt the market because it's obvious, but how about your strategy to cope with these changes, like being a dry cargo owner? Will you adopt some of these new things that people go for?
To be very honest, Sava, we have been looking at a lot of different options, but have been very, very hesitant to invest the huge amount of capital required for scrubbers, predominantly because we don't believe in this type of technology. I think the thinking behind it is very, very wrong. We think the whole idea of, just as Mr. Adesso was just as I'm mentioning, the idea of putting the burden on the end user rather than the product itself is ludicrous. And of course what complicates it even more is the lack of clarity in the previous years, leading now in the very last minute to this whole debate over open and closed loop scrubbers or hybrids or whatnot. I agree that it is too complicated on the very last minute. I expect to see a lot of problems unless reason prevails and the IMO decides to take more drastic steps to assist the industry. Because I beg to
last
differ.
Last minute intervention, you mean?
Yes, right. Yes, because I beg to differ. There will be supply, but we don't know what that supply will cause. We're talking about blends that have not been tested, that nobody knows how we can safely use in our main engines and with what parameters and what type of lubrication. We are talking about very grey areas in our insurance markets with respect to cargo claims that will arise when you cannot deliver your product on time, or when the equipment breaks down, whether it be scrubber or the main engine itself or whatever. And there are a lot of question marks surrounding this that need to be addressed ahead of time, not as they happen.
We're running out of time a little bit in terms of the market, but yeah, I
absolutely,
get your point.
Yes.
Mr. Pittas, I would like to ask you the second part of the question only, because we know the reply for the first part. Are you taking any specific strategies to cope with this new reality that's coming for intershipping?
Well, I'll answer the first part, but very briefly as well.
Okay.
Because I have a view here that the IMO, and some people said it here, the IMO has taken decisions which affect us, which are wrongly taken and in the wrong direction. I just want to remind people about the ballast water management system and putting up this equipment. And we all did it, it's past now, it's history, but we can criticize it afterwards and say, was that needed? I mean, couldn't we just exchange ballast just when you go out of the port and then we would have solved the problem? The IMO is affected by the industry that wants to create new equipment and put new things into the market and on board the ships. The scrubber, in my opinion, is the same. Why don't you refine the product within 30 factories or 30 refineries in the world, and you want to build 20,000 small refineries floating around with people that don't know how to use it well, and you suppose that you're solving the problem that way. So I think the IMO was flawed. I don't want to go more into that. It's a wrong decision. It's a decision that has been taken, and for sure the effect is that this disruption is going to be huge, and at the end of the day, I think it's going to be beneficial. I agree with both Petros and Andreas. It's going to be beneficial to the industry because any disruption and any inefficiency will result in the need, you know, ships stopping, needing more ships at the end, going slower, whatever. So, yes, I think the end result will be good for all. I don't. We're not installing scrappers on our ships. We have smaller ships, Panamaxes and feeder container ships. I think that 96 to 97% of the fleet in Panamaxes and feeder container ships is not going to have scrubbers. The 2 or 3% that do have scrubbers may or may not make money. I don't know. It will all depend on the difference of prices. But the markets are formed by what the great majority is doing. So the great majority, 97% of our market, will be relying on the traditional supply and demand for ships question and will benefit from the fact that there will be disruption and delays, and therefore I'm quite confident that the markets will be quite good. But if the scrubber players are going to win and make more money than what we others will do, I don't know. They are investing $3 million.
It remains to be seen.
They are investing $3 million and they want to make that back. And they, some say they will get it back in a year, some think in 3 years. We will have to see where the prices of fuel end up.
Thank you very much for your input. I will change the question a bit for Mr. Hadjiyiannou because I think we all got the idea of what are the answers and there's two different opinions and approaches. Same topic, but there's been recently some discussions and criticism about the open loop type of scrubber. And I would like your opinion, Mr. Hadjiyiannou, of what do you think and about this criticism, and what is your opinion whether this is going to be harmful for the environment or not?
Good afternoon to everyone, and nice to see you all in Cyprus for another year for Capital Link conference. Well, the last 6 months we've heard it all. I mean, we've heard that IMO is applying a regulation without being prepared and without giving option to ship owners, as if this regulation appeared out of the blue in 2019. This regulation is there the last 12 years. We knew it was coming. We were hoping initially for an extension, including myself, 5 years ago when the market was terrible, 3 years ago when the market was terrible. I was expecting some sort of magic hand to extend the regulation to 2025, and that was our hope. But we knew the regulation was coming, and we were anxious of how we would deal with it. And nobody would sit down and discuss, and the industry wouldn't care at all. They say the refiners will find the fuel and our ships will burn the compliant fuel or whatever they give us to burn. Suddenly, and none of us had an idea in 2016 or 2017 or a thought or 2015 that we will store scrubbers on our ships, simply because scrubbers were very expensive. So we knew that the industry will solve the problem itself for the ship owners. And we didn't care about it, and we say 2020 will come. And they will give us the proper fuel to burn it. So we're 10 months away, and suddenly, a few months ago, 3 months ago, 4 months ago, in September, October, we start worrying about our engines, if they would be able to burn it, if they would break down, if we will have problems. We start hearing companies that they were not at the forefront runners on environmental issues, start worrying what will happen. We want to have a level playing field. Then the level playing field turned out into the other comment of experience building period. We need more time to, the regulation should delay. Now people start worrying about open loop systems, if the 3% of the fleet that will use open loop systems, if the water is coming out from those ships is polluting the oceans, and this will harm the fish and will have consequences terrible for our health, etc., etc. I think there's a lot of hypocrisy out of this regulation. There is a lot of people who were trying to fit and get the slots for the 2019 scrappers. They didn't move in time. Some companies like Starbulk, like other companies, mostly listed companies, took that option. We don't know if we will make money in the end, if we will make small money, big money or no money. Other people are still worrying about us if we will make money or not making money. This is a funny thing out of it. So I thank them very much for worrying about our well-being. But what is more important, and I think it's a big mistake we are doing, and many union of ship owners are doing this mistake. I think with all this talk we are making on the environmental front, about the 3% of the fleet that will have scrappers and the water that's coming out of these scrappers. And we are forgetting that these ships will have emissions in the oceans that will be 5 times less than the emissions of the compliant fuels. We forget this aspect. With all this challenge we are putting ahead of us, we are undermining the authority of the IMO, of the classification societies, which always we wanted to keep at the front rank, and to have them as a ruling authority. We are inviting in European Union commissions, regulators, other bodies to govern shipping, and this we will be paid back dearly for this mistake we are doing. All these people, they will come back. Already people are discussing that the ship owners should be doing this and the other and the other. And I think we are harming ourselves. And at the end of the day, owners will benefit out of this regulation, not only the environment. Owners will benefit. You will be burning more expensive fuel oil, which will increase freight rates. It will slow down the fleet, and this is only positive for our industry. Now, if Petros makes money, or if Navios will make money, or if Safe Bulkers will make money, let their shareholders worry about it. Don't worry so much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Pappas wants to just make a comment here.
Yes, a quick couple of comments.
Because we're running out of time.
Couple of comments. First of all, we're talking about open loop and closed loop. You know what the difference is? The difference is that closed loop actually uses caustic soda, and as soon as it is a few miles out of the port, they just dump the whole thing in the sea. So it's not like closed loop, keep them in a tank and give them out to some port facility. So actually, the only difference is in port. Okay, so that, because maybe people have not understood that. Second thing I want to say, there are a number of, to answer the first part of your question, there are a number of studies that are in favor of scrappers, and there are a few studies that are not. The ones that are in favor of study of scrappers, they have come out very late. The Japanese, the DNV, GL, even the Swedes, and this was governmental actually bodies. And of course there are, there's a German study, which however was a study which was at its beginning. It has not been completed. Five samples. It's not enough to take decisions on that. But just think of
two things. Japanese is different than the
Japanese went through a lot of detail, and they also did an 10-year accumulation study.
We don't have a lot of time for all the details, but you can tell us the summary of
the. They studied the impact on sea organisms because they're very interested about their fisheries.
With the support of the EU, and that's why the EU has been blamed, and all the guys who took part in that. And I think they must answer to simple questions, because some people will lose a lot of money, or they will lose full credibility when December comes or October comes, and it's so obvious that the world is going to end up in a mess, that they're going to have to take it all back. That's
I completely understand
the
that.
The matter.
It looks like we are way past this point, and so any new regulations, any new discussions or regulations, then we have to take into account people that they have already invested based on the previous regulation. So I think it's going to be even a bigger mess in that respect. Let's see how it's going to work out.
It has to be definitive.
I have one, based on your comment just now, so do you expect to... Obviously, you don't expect to have enough compliant fuel for 2020.
I don't know, it's not for me.
That's a question I'd like to ask anyway. I don't know if Fena has a strong opinion about that.
I think actually the problem was going to be more.
But for, like with 1 minute or 2 months.
I think the problem is going to be moral for a head fuel oil rather than a compliant fuel.
Okay.
I'm not worried about the compliant fuel. I think that the only way the refineries would have produced it is if they knew that there was a cut-off date. There is no regulation that shipping will apply unless they know that there is a cut-off date. Why the refineries to make the investment? It's billions of dollars to produce a product if they found that this date is, it would not be applied. If 2020, 1st of January, would become 1st of January 2025. So the only way for this product is everything is, we heard it from ExxonMobil in the morning, everything in shipping and in the world trade is a matter of supply and demand. If there is demand for it, the refineries will produce it. So they cannot produce it 3 years ahead because the owners want to test it and be sure that in 2020 this product will be available and we will sleep at night peacefully and knowing that in 3 years' time this product will be there. It's a cut-off date. Now they know that this cut-off date cannot change because it cannot change, irrespective of few windows left and right. Now they know that this product, this date is applicable. One after the other, the oil majors and the physical suppliers are putting out their specs and coming to us. Now bank and brokers, the last, let's say, couple of months, are giving us in various spots compliant fuel of various characteristics. So I don't see a major disruption. And also HFO, I don't expect that there will be shortages in the major ports. I heard the comment made earlier in the morning about why a barge owner will use his barges for heavy fuel oil and then he will not turn them, they will not be able to turn into compliant fuel and things like that. I believe that 10% of the fleet, 10% of the quantity that will be consumed will be HFO for the next year or so, for after 2020, because it's 4% of the fleet, but it's a bigger ships, so it's around 10% of the oil. So I guess the physical suppliers will use 9 barges for compliant fuel and 1 barge for HFO. We will have some more delay in getting our bunkers in Singapore or in Fujairah or in other places. Instead of getting the bunkers in 12 hours, we're getting them in 24 hours or 36 hours. Let it be, never mind, ships are time charter. It's nothing wrong with that. Generally, I think it's a regulation that ship owners would be, we are blessed because it's happening now for us and the environment, and we shouldn't be complaining about this. The Palacote treatment, it was a different. It's all the cost is on our shoulders.
Based on what you're discussing, on what you're talking now, how long do you think the fuel, the high sulfur fuel oil will be around then, based the way the market is developing over the next 1 or 2 years? Will it be around for a long time, for good,
it will be
not for a long
it
time?
It will be forever because it's physically produced and 10% of the quantity that's consumed is heavy fuel oil. So I think it will be forever. Now, when the spread will become from 200 or 150 or 100 down to $25, you know, sometimes maybe you don't want to burn to use your scrubber and use your ships burning compliant fuel from the start, you know. So, but again, this each company will decide. For me, if my ship is, if I can find compliant fuel at less than 50 tons difference from the HFO, I will not use a scrubber. I will simply burn the other fuel.
I'd like to ask someone else if he has also an opinion on how long the high sulfur heavy fuel could be around.
Yeah.
Just within 1 minute, please.
Yeah, it would be forever because on shore there is nothing wrong with the with the 3% or the 4% or the 5% sulfur content. This is because you apply calcium and then what becomes, it becomes the ceramic tiles. We use it for industry or the houses without the tires. That's how we make them. So there's nothing wrong with that. It's the marine fuel oil that has to be free from sulfur.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Pappas.
It, co- costs like between $500 million and $1 billion each refinery to do the necessary upgrading to be able to crack the crude and leave no heavy fuel leftovers. And I think that a pretty big percentage of refineries actually are the old style, maybe up to 40% or so of the refineries. So it will take a long time before they go through this expense and before heavy fuel oil disappears. And until then, can you imagine if heavy fuel oil was totally banned and vessels burn about 4 million barrels per day of heavy fuel oil? If you multiply that by 365 days, because vessels run every day, not they don't stop over the weekends, that's 1.5 billion barrels. If you divided that by 2 billion barrels, which is a VLCC, you would need 750 VLCCs to store this heavy fuel oil.
Sounds like a good idea.
So perhaps you understand that having scrubbers actually disposes of a part of the problem. Plus, if you did not use heavy fuel oil and all of us wanted to use MGO, then what Andreas is saying about MGO and whether it would be available or not, it would not be available. And if it was available, it would be at $2,000 per ton. So one has to see also the financial consequences to humanity about that.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going off this very hot subject, obviously. And I'm going to something lighter. I'd like to ask the panelists to give us a general idea, not too much detail, on what challenges they face in their sector at present, and if they are expecting any catalyst that could happen and boost their market. But let's not talk about scrubbers, because we have talked extensively about anything else. So I'll start with Mr. Hadjiyiannis for the dry cargo market.
Are you limited?
Any challenges and any expectations that would help the market to dry cargo market?
Yeah, apart from the scrubbers, we have a trade war. Right? We have a trade war, which is anybody's guess. You have Trump on the one side and Chinese on the other side. It's anybody's guess. Right? I tend to believe that the Chinese are fighting a war they cannot win. So at the end of the day, they will find a solution. But that will give a big boost to the sentiment of the market. Now, in real terms, in real transportation, it's not sure how much it will affect in the short term. Because, for instance, on the finished goods, in anticipation of the increase of tariffs to go into the States, okay, the shelves are full of stocks, the stocks are full of stockhouses, are full of cargo. So it may not be an additional transportation, it may be lesser of the containers. And on the agriculture, the grains we're talking about, all right, it has been going on from Brazil, now it will come from the States. What big difference it would make?
It's
the sentiment.
Okay. If I can ask Mr. Pittas to talk about the container market. Because we have plenty of representation of the dry cargo, we'd like to hear something about the container market as well.
I think it's quite similar to what Andrea said. The biggest problem of the world right now is that global growth is slowing and globalization is retreating. So this is the biggest issue that we have generally, and yes, scrubbers is a very small part. So this is the major concern. If Xi and Trump are able to find a solution between them, and I think they will, but not by the 31st of March, already they've extended that date, but they will find a solution before the end of the year, I think, because Trump needs an agreement before that, because we have elections again for him, and he wants to win them, and the economy, as we say, it's the economy, stupid, is what gets one elected. So he will try and find an agreement with the Chinese. The Chinese also want the agreement even more desperately than he wants. And we will have a change in sentiment. If that change in sentiment leads to an improvement globally, and we avoid the smaller problems, which are still huge, Brexit, Italy, whatever have you, we can see growth picking up. With growth picking up, I think that we will see an improvement in the container market. It's very closely related to the container trade with the growth of global GDP, and that will suffice. We have the best influence of what we were discussing before, the scrubber incidents, that nobody's building ships because they don't know what type of ships will be needed. So supply of new ships is going to be low. Therefore, we are quite optimistic that 2020 can be a good year.
So similar story with the dry cargo at the moment.
The only difference is that the dry cargo depends more on China than the global trade, which is the container trade. The container trade also depends on China, but dry cargo is particularly China.
Ms. Mylona, could you have your opinion about the dry cargo market and any challenges other than scrubbers?
Well, I will agree with Mr. Andreas that it really does feel like we're inside the perfect storm right now. Just about everything that could go wrong has gone wrong, whether it's cyclical or exceptional. Well, between the violent dam disruption, for example, it's taken out hundreds of thousands of tons of cargo from the Cape Size market to the Chinese coal import quotas and the disruption in the C5 route as well. And everything happened at the same time. But these are all short-term problems, and although they do look huge right now, they will ultimately be resolved. I think the biggest hurdle for us living in the Western Hemisphere is how we will remain competitive going forward vis-a-vis our Eastern Hemisphere competitors. And this predominantly because we're all faced with the same challenges, but we have a much higher OPEX, much less capital availability, and much less flexibility by comparison. This, I think, will be the biggest hurdle.
Thank you very much. If I could ask Mr. Pappas to give us his idea on the same question, but for the tanker sector, as you are pretty much involved in that as well, for any challenges at the moment and any expectations of it, help or boost the sector.
Yes. Yes, but I'm predominantly a dry cargo. So let me just say something very quick about the dry. Because everybody
we have a lot of representation on dry.
Everybody talks about the short term. I think that the long term on dry is a little bit precarious because the coal is a slowly dying commodity. Iron ore in China probably reached its limits. These are commodities that basically represent 50% of trade. So there are issues about the medium term as well. Although I'm positive about the next 2 or 3 years, as I said, because of the regulations, the environmental regulations, there are major headwinds, and also China's slowing down their economy. So this was dry. Now, as far as tankers are concerned, with the limited knowledge I have, I think that the best suited vessels are going to be the product tankers because exactly of the environmental regulations, because there's going to be a lot of movement between areas that have added quantities, produce added quantities of heavy fuel oil, and others that have bigger quantities of gas oil, and they may need to move it around in order to satisfy ports that don't have one of the two bunker types available. So I think that product tankers will benefit, and I think also crude carriers may benefit if there's going to be a need for storage for heavy fuel oil. So I am actually more positive about the liquid sectors going forward than our own. But again, as I said, in my view, all four segments are going to be doing well in the next 2-3 years, exactly because of slowing down speeds and additional scrapping of hires, because you need to either to clean your tanks to get guys oil, or because you need to install scrappers.
Thank you very much. Mr. Hadjiyiannis, you want to add something?
Yes, I agree with Petros on the tanker side. I will only add that if we, hopefully we will get to an agreement between Trump and the Chinese, then the Chinese will try to, and it will come to the office too now, they will try to minimize it. Balance the trade balances, and the best solution apart from the coal, right, it's the oil. So we already see that happening. The VLs, for instance, they get all by VLs, they will get all the oil from the States, and that increases the ton mile by 2-3 times. So, and that's the reason.
It's a positive story for the tankers.
Yeah, it's a very positive for the big issues.
I would like to jump to our next topic, which has to do with financing for the growth of the shipping companies. We have a different type of company of ship owners sitting next to us, private companies, public companies. So I would like to ask you if you see enough availability of finance from the banks these days, or not, and if you are considering currently alternative sources of financing, and what would those be at present? So if I can ask Mr. Hajioannou on that.
I don't know why you are asking me, but I think financing is always available, and I think the banks in general, they want to lend the same 50, 60, 70 companies in Greece. So you will always find finance. When you are profitable, you want to expand your fleet. When you are not profitable and there are turbulence in the market, you don't need finance because you don't need more ships. So I think the finance would never be a problem for decent companies, for good companies. Coming to the issue of the market, because I wanted to have a comment there that I think nobody touched. I think that we are missing an important element. I agree that coal will be slowing down in China. The iron ore is at its limits, but you have India. India will be replacing China on the coal front. So this is a positive on the dry bulk. But the most important is we are past the worst years of the market. And the markets generally in all sectors, but in dry bulk that I am following closely, are more finely balanced. For example, in 2015-16 we had to struggle because we had the over ordering and the over tonnage market with 3 years of 100 million deadweight deliveries each in 2010, 11 and 12. All this hit us with the slowdown of economies, of emerging economies, and hit us in 15 and 16 with very bad rates. Now, we had a very healthy market in 2018. I think all of us were profitable, and the public companies, we know their accounts, they were all profitable. The good and the bads and the averages, they were all profitable in 2018. We saw in January a dramatic drop of the market. Why? Well, you had the trade war. We all are waiting to see the Twitter, if there's a tweet overnight that will change the sentiment. We had the Brazilian accident with 40 million of iron ore going out of the market and Cape Size falling from $20,000 a day to $4,000 a day. We had the floods in Australia, which lost so much production of coal for 1 or 2 months. You see now, 6 weeks later, so the market in dry bulk went from 14,000 in the spot market in the beginning of January to 4,000 in the end of January. Now we are still in February, the market is back at 10,000. I fixed a ship when I was outside at $10,000 a day for one trip today from India via South America to the Far East. I had three other charters at $9,000, and when the ship was fixed, they are asking, why did you give the ship to the other charter? And we wanted to pay the same money or a little bit more. So it shows you that the markets are finally balanced, and this is in our favor. And I think all these regulations that are coming is blessing for ship owners. Compliant fuel will lead us to more scrapping. Ballast water treatment will lead us to more scrapping. Scrappers will lead us to more scrapping. It will not be like 2018, 5 million tons to go to the scrapyard. 2019, I believe, will be more than 20 million going to the scrapyard, simply because the repair cost is going up tremendously, because the yards are fully booked with all these installations, the retrofits of scrappers, of ballast water treatments. You go to dry dock an older vessel, and they're asking you 60 or 70% higher prices than what we were paying last year. So I think with a finely balanced market and scrapping going up, I'm optimistic we will have positive markets, plus the fact of interest rates going down with the recent decision of the Fed. So I believe that we are in a good cycle for the next 2 or 3 years.
It's a positive scenario for dry cargo, for sure, and tankers, as we can see. I would like to ask again the question for Mr. Pittas to reply on the financing, though. Are you exploring alternative sources of financing other than just old bank financing?
Yes, well, financing has always been available. We have had so many discussions the last 10 years about there not being financing available, and there has been always a lot of financing available, and this has led to the overordering that we had between 2013 and 2015, and the still very big order books that we had. The only reason that we have not been investing in the last couple of years is not the lack of financing, is that we don't know what to order. So financing is there, it's become more expensive for the smaller companies. The companies represented here are a little bit bigger, so they have access to conventional bank financing, but smaller private companies find it more difficult. They do finance themselves with a higher spread than what we are able to get, so that's one of the advantages of being relatively large. The problem I see is a little bit touching upon to what Nicole said before. There is a lot of financing coming from the Far East and China, especially lately, with all these leasing schemes, and recently we saw leasing companies becoming leasing or owners of ships and ordering vessels themselves. And this, I think, is one danger that we have in the market. Financing is not a problem.
Why is it a danger? In terms of more new buildings or in terms of what?
In terms of more new buildings, in terms of making financing cheaper again and helping us, get greedy and say, oh, I can order a ship with so little, putting down so little of my money, and I can order a new ship. And that's what we do. We overorder. And the banks help us. We are not alone.
Thank you very much. So I guess there's plenty of finance available, because we listened to different views before, but it's okay.
I don't know, maybe the other members of the panel have a different view to that, but I think the financing is available.
Possibly. So if I can ask again.
3 years ago, financing was not available. 3 or 4 years ago. If you remember, there were 50 to 70 banks a few years back, and then 3 or 4 years ago, there were 5 or 6 of them left. But at that point in time, the Chinese came in. And specifically, the Chinese leasing companies at the beginning, mostly for new buildings. And that's what, that's who we used, at least in our company. Right now, financing is back.
Ms. Mylona, do you have something to comment on the finance?
I would agree with the gentleman that it has been readily available, at least for those who are strong and healthy. But I do expect financing to become less available going forward for all, simply because of, again, over-regulation in the banking sector. Basel IV alone will mean less capital at a higher cost. Traditional ship finance is only a small proportion of bank portfolios. So once it becomes more expensive or less profitable, whichever way you see it, for the bank, then ultimately it becomes less interesting as well. And I think going forward, we will see a lot less interest from traditional ship banks. And this will lead to more fancy alternatives for the ship, I think, inevitably.
Alternative sources of finances, again. I will go to my last question for today. It has to do with Cyprus. And how do you see Cyprus developing as a maritime hub? But also, what are your thoughts about the Cyprus flag? Which we understand from the discussion today that it's one of the most popular flags. So if I can start with Mr. Hadjiyiannis on the Cyprus as a maritime hub and the Cypriot flag.
Well, I think the record talks of itself. Right? It's an impressive, very impressive development with both with Cyprus as a maritime hub and the flag, the Cyprus flag. And I think it will continue. It not only will continue, it will accelerate in both angles, in both those sectors. The reason for that is permanent. It's not just so happen now. It's because of the know-how that the Cypriots or the Greeks in general have, the know-how of the industry, the know-how of how to operate the registry and to solve problems, which you don't, you think it's a simple thing, but you don't meet with other registries. Here you talk to people who know, understand, and they can make swift decisions, which is so important for shipping. And the attitude of Cypriots, I mean, that's a good thing that we inherited from the Greeks. The open-minded and the knowledge, the know. But we did not inherit, or we did not get the latest disadvantage of the Greeks for the last decades, not long ago, where you have the bureaucracy, the competition of the various parties and the levels of the classes between the people. It's a natural thing for the people when it comes to shipping and to business,
in their culture
themselves, in their culture. So it's only good for Cyprus. Shipping holds very good fortunes for Cyprus. It's a good thing. It has started, we have come so far, and it's only a long way to go, and it will go that way.
Mr. Hadjian, could you have your comments as well, since you are someone who moved back to Cyprus recently?
Yes, it's not so recent, it's 4 years already. So, the Cyprus Union of Shipowners that were all members were very strong supporters of Cyprus flag and shipping in Cyprus in general. I think apart from all this and all the service we have and the very good work of the Deputy Ministry and the Minister of Shipping, Mrs. Pilivi, and all the people in the ministry, they are very, very cooperative and they are solving problems and they are there to give a fair treatment to the whole industry, whether you are adopting scrubbers or non-scrubbers or all this. They see that the common benefit. But Cyprus also, for me, the last 4 years I'm living here in Limassol, I find it a very international city. with very high living standards, a very safe city to have your children in, at schools and going around. It's a city that is modern. You can go for dinner at 8 o'clock. You no need to go 10 or 10:30. You can work from your offices without being distracted or without having unpleasant visits. You can really focus on an international business. We are here in Cyprus and we are running an international business. Our ships will carry coal and other stuff, and iron ore and grain, from Australia to China and from South Africa to China and from South America to Japan or to Korea. It's a blessing for a country to run this business from a place that we're running international business, and we're not asking for something, and we're not polluting the air, we're not polluting the sea, we are only offering to the GDP of this country, the President of the Republic, the Ministry of Shipping. All these people have seen this angle and they have made our life easy and comfortable. I mean, our people, they are enjoying better salaries here. It's much less taxation. The contributions to the state are very reasonable. All these are huge benefits for a shipping company to stay competitive. I don't think we could have managed to stay competitive from many other countries. I mean, the shipping market, it has ups and downs. I was telling to Petros last week, we met in London on another occasion. Do you know what is the average of Baltic Panamax index the last 7 years? Give me the average. And Petros tell me, what is it, about 10,000? We need 12 or 12 and a half to break even on our investments, especially with new ships. I told him, no, it's not 10,000. The average is from 2012 until 2019, the start of 2019, is 8,200. How we manage to survive with 8,200? Because we spend 12 hours in the office every day, we try to fix a little bit better than the others in the market. We keep our ships properly maintained and running them with lower OPEX. I mean, we are magicians. What we are doing here is magical, and many companies cannot survive. Of course, we are burning some money some years from those who accumulated from the good time. But, you know, you need to work in a stable environment. You cannot be distracted. And Cyprus, if I would say the biggest benefit I found in Cyprus, I can work competitively. I am competing with, not with Aristides and Petros and Andreas and Nicole, we are competing with the Chinese and the Singaporeans, which they have a different structure in their countries for shipping.
The Germans?
The Germans, they had different, yes. Yes. But the Germans, they all came here, so they were very clever. So this is the biggest benefit.
Thank you very much. As a Greek that has also moved to Cyprus, they think set up Mr. Pappas, I'd like also your comments on Cyprus as a hub and also the Cyprus flag.
Well, you got me worried with this 8,200. You see me at the traffic lights begging for money. Well, you know, we have an office here already and we're very happy to have it. And sometimes I personally say that I would have no problem moving and living myself in Cyprus. My son is already here part of the time, but I like the country, I like the people, and as far as business is concerned, I think that Cypriots are very business-minded and very practical people, very organized and willing to assist. So I mean, what else could we ask for? And of course they have amazing shipping ministers, Mr. Dimitriadis previously, Mrs. Pilidis right now. I mean, we're very happy with them. We see them like 10 times more often than we see our own Greek shipping minister. Now regarding the flag, this is the only dent, actually, and the dent is that this problem with Turkey. So if you want to have your smaller vessels listed with the Cypriot flag, then you cannot call Turkey. And that is a trading problem. But on our bigger vessels, we have flagged some of them into Cypriot flag, and we intend to do more of those. So personally, I'm all for it, and I'm very happy I'm here. And this is the only place I come every year to sit on a panel, I have to tell you that.
That's great.
Well, I don't want to waste your time saying how great it is, because I think just by being here we've all proven that we feel that way. I think maybe the only thing that would keep me from saying that Cyprus is the perfect marine hub is that it still has a very, very young in age maritime academy. But I am very pleased to see that the government has taken very, very serious interest in promoting this aspect as well. I think this will help the staffing of both our companies going forward, but also the DMS. It's an important parameter of calling oneself a maritime company.
Thank you very much.
Since everybody said something, and we have not brought our shipping activities yet here in Cyprus, and the reason being that the Greek government has treated shipping in a much better way than most of us were afraid that they would treat us. And had they not done that, we would have been fully here and others as well. But having lived here for over 2 years now, I'm very happy to be living here and to see how pro-business this country is and how you're helping the Greeks, I would say, including the Greek Cypriots, into making this a real good hub. And I want to thank Nikos Bournosis again for organizing this. This brings us all together here. And we're putting Cyprus where it has to be. And as Paulie said, we are an international business. What we need for our main office here is to have the services that the Cypriot Ministry is making sure that we get. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pittas. I have been advised that we also have time for some questions. So I'm going to take some questions from the floor. If anyone has a question to ask our panelists, here you are, you can let us know. Can you say your name and your company when you introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Enrico Picoza, and I am with CNET Maritime Services. And I just had a question in regards to scrubbers. So scrubbers, it seems like they're just one more thing that can break down. So my question was in regards to the ship owner, is at what point is a scrubber, assuming that everything is going as planned and as predicted, which we clearly know isn't, at what point in a vessel's life is it worth getting the scrubbers and adding it to the vessel compared to scrapping the vessel or using compliant fuels?
Would you like to take the answer? Mr. Pappas?
Some people say that younger vessels should be equipped with scrubbers, but we say that older vessels should also be equipped with scrubbers, because think about a vessel which is like, let's say, 15 years old. She's not an eco vessel, and therefore when the charter looks at that vessel, he says, okay, this vessel is about, out of 100, it's about 75th in rank. But then if you install a scrubber on that vessel and there's only like 5 or 10% of vessels with scrubbers, and provided that heavy fuel oil is cheaper enough than compliant fuel, then that vessel from the 75th or 80th or whatever position may go up to 20th or 15th. So therefore, I would not install a scrubber on a 20-year-old vessel or on a 17-year-old vessel, but I think around 15 or so would be something that I would definitely consider.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Hadjiyiannis as well.
Well, I think as things stand now, and if the IMO insists on the 1st of January, then every ship should have a scrapper yesterday. But it's still a big if. And my opinion, as I said before, I don't think this will happen.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Anyone else? Any other question? I think we are all covered. Thank you very much, the panelists. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. That's the end, actually. We have a comment from Mr. Tsavlidis. So please, you can.
Then we will ask the panelists and our minister to please come all together.
Goodbye. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we do have to come to an end. It was a long, strenuous day. Very fragmented, exhausting to a certain extent, but as always, we think out of the box, and I'd say that I'd like to thank Nicholas and Olga and all of the team for organizing this conference, because throughout the day we've covered a lot of volatile topics. It's unusual for conferences to last that long with a full house late this time in the afternoon, having gone about 1 hour over time as well. But also, I think, I think so important is that we can be transparent here. We have people on the panel here who have different views. They, for example, they're completely different aspects towards their business. And I think it's so healthy, so invigorating to be able to sit in a room with such an audience and literally say what you mean and mean what you say. Because unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, we are surrounded by a lot of infrastructure with what I call with hidden agendas. There are scenarios which are not particularly conversant to the way we want to be, because the people on the panel here are very, very experienced. They've got a lot of scar tissue over the years from mistakes that have been made, and they've also achieved a lot in their lives from actually being daring, being as extreme in Tolmiri, and having the enthusiasm to actually think in a way which is not necessarily down to logistics, nuts and bolts and logic. I'm sure that the likes of Mr. Hadjiyiannis or Mr. Mylona or Peter Pappas or anybody or the other parts of the panel, is that they don't make decisions pure on logic. They actually have the gut feeling, the hunch, and they feel that something is correct and they go and do it. Last but not least, I just want to mention on a more sensitive point, because we have a fairly volatile last scenario here, this last presentation. In my usual romantic self, I want to quote Odysseus Elitis. I'll say it in Greek first, then perhaps I'll give as well rough translation as I can. And this goes for Greece and Cyprus, by the way, because both Elitis and Seferis refer to the Greeks as being Hellenes, which basically means engulfs both Greeks and Cypriots. Εάν αποσυνδέσεις στην Ελλάδα, στο τέλος θα δεις να σου απομένουν μία ηλιά, ένα αμπέλι και ένα καράβι, που σημαίνει πως μάλλον τόσα τα ξαναφτιάχνεις. Rough translation, if we dissemble Greece, one will find an olive tree, a grapevine and a ship, which means that with these three ingredients, we can rebuild our own country. Ladies and gentlemen, that statement as well is basically also signifies the fact that as we had this volatile topic earlier with the scrubbers, we can group Hamlet as well there, to be or not to be, scrubbers to be or not to be. The point of the matter is that we will survive one way or the other. We will be able to proceed and succeed. And quite frankly, at this stage, I think it's amazing that we've actually spent a whole day being so constructive with such a great audience, and you, Deputy Minister, being here. President, we very much thank you. And I must apologize profusely to some of the presenters whilst passing on, well, I wouldn't say rude notes, but funny notes to trying to keep a time schedule in time, which I probably failed by at least half an hour, which I again apologize to all of you. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
if we may have our minister, our deputy minister, close the conference, have a stay there. You can join us at the podium and I will. And before you start, I just wanted to say to everybody, thank you very much. It is almost 6:30. We've been here since 8:45. It's full room. And I'd like to thank you all from the bottom of my heart for joining us today. And I would like to say that the only reason that we are able to do this is because we have tremendous friends like you who support us. We do quality work. We are very committed. We're very loyal to what we do. But without the friendship and support of all of you, nothing could happen. So thank you very, very much. The comment that Petros made, if you allow me to repeat, that you come here every year and it's the only place you go, and of course, Polis and everybody else, and all the friends we made, I think that is the biggest capital that we have for all this enterprise. Thank you.
So three very quick comments from me as well before we close. First of all, warm thanks to everyone for being here today. Thank you so much for staying until the end. Thank you for all your lovely comments on Cyprus. We really appreciate it, and it's what gives us the strength to keep trying to make Cyprus a better place and a stronger maritime hub. Second comment, I just want to say with my regulator hat on, because I feel that the regulator needs to also have a voice in all of this discussion about the environment, that we are not here to judge whether method A, method B or method C is a good method. We are here to foster the decisions of the IMO and to implement them and to make sure that each ship owner and each shipping company operating within our cluster is free to make the choice of method A, method B, method C, and we'll have our full support in implementing it and making it happen. I agree somewhat with some of you that if one method had been imposed by the IMO at an earlier stage, that may have simplified matters, but it would also have been a pretty dictatorial way of going forward, if not because it's not, it doesn't allow a free market to operate in a free way. We do live in a free market. Unfortunately, commercial decisions are part of everyday life, and that's a fact that I think we've all come to experience and accept. So we have our full support in every decision that you make, and we very much appreciate you being here. Thank you to everyone. And last but not least, third point, thank you so much, Nikos Bornozis. Thank you so much, Capital Link. This is a huge achievement, and we're so grateful. Thank you.
I thank everybody, but let me make a personal thank you to Lukas Barbaris and to Andreas Petrou. Again, we made tremendous friends here, but these two gentlemen have been really above board helping us. Thank you so much.